crisis support. I ask the clerk to read the motion, please.
That this Assembly recognises the importance of collaborative and well-resourced services which support those in mental health crisis across Northern Ireland. Notes with concern a COVID-19 survey conducted by the Stress, Trauma and Research Conditions Laboratory at Queen's University Belfast, which found that one-third of people locally met the criteria for depression, highlights the success of the Multi Agency Triage Team partnership between the health and social care sector, the PSNI and the Northern Ireland Ambulance Service in providing on-the-spot mental health support to people in emotional crisis, and calls on the Minister of Health to commit urgently to the expansion and funding of this project to all health and social care trusts.
Thank you. I call Mr. Alex Easton to move.
Moved.
Thank you. Just one second. Thank you, Mr. Easton. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour, 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. I call on Mr. Alec Easton to open the debate on the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Principal Speaker. As everybody knows, we as an Assembly have been recently very much united on the need and urgency to tackle mental health in our society. We are all aware of the significant increase in mental health issues due to COVID-19 and the results of lockdown. In order to try to tackle this, a recent study conducted by Queen's University called Stress, Trauma and Research Conditions, or STARC, has recently been undertaken, and the results are extremely worrying about the state of our mental health across our population. Some of the statistics and findings are as follows. 470 people were surveyed, with 3 out of 10, which is 30%, meeting the criteria for anxiety. And 1 out of every 3 met the criteria for depression. On COVID-19-related post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD, 20% met the criteria. 41% were extremely worried about becoming infected with COVID-19, and 64% were extremely worried about infecting others. Concerns were also expressed about the following. With health service concerns, with 72% of individuals being highly concerned about the ability of the health service to care for COVID-19 patients if the situation became worse. On job security, 28% were highly concerned about their job security because of COVID-19, and 50% highly concerned about the financial implications of COVID-19. Concerns about school closures, with 41% being highly concerned about the impact of school closures on children during the COVID-19 pandemic. Concerns about government, with 49% were extremely worried about the government's ability to manage the COVID-19 situation. Overall, the findings showed that those with prior mental health condition and those who had high exposure to COVID-19-related information via the media, the young, and those highly concerned about being infected, and key workers suffered the most with mental health issues. I found it very interesting how our media has been identified as contributing to affecting the well-being of our population, and that is something to think about. The following recommendations were made in the study, and I believe the Health Minister and his department should look at these, and they probably already have. There are groups of individuals who may be more vulnerable to experiencing mental health issues during this time. Government bodies and other relevant decision makers must be mindful of these groups when creating or amending COVID-19 related policies. Given the impact of COVID-19 media exposure on mental ill health, clear media guidelines on the reporting of COVID-19 information should be drafted and implemented. There should be a public health campaign to educate the public on reputable sources of COVID-19 information in the media and how to manage their COVID-19 consumption. And on this point, I recently mentioned to the Health Minister at the Health Committee about how we can promote the COVID-19 vaccine when it arrives, as there is a clear mistrust within some in the wider community due to misinformation, lies, and other factors. Concerns around the financial implications of the pandemic include job security must be carefully considered by government. Priority at policy level should be a plan efficiently and effectively for how a potential increase for mental health services will be handled in light of the pandemic. The study also reports that service provision will be important to improve outreach of services to those who may have difficulty accessing them due to the nature of their diagnosis, those with concerns about social distancing or infection, individuals who are considering or are considered at high risk and may be shielding for prolonged periods, and those who may not be able to access services digitally. Academics and clinicians must work together in order to help bridge the gap for those who are unable to access services. This includes the implementation of more regular follow-ups with clients. Further consideration from both a research and service provider standpoint should consider how positive mental health and well-being could be fostered during periods of isolation. Mental health organisations, particularly in the charitable sector, will need to be adequately funded to ensure easily accessible mental health support is available when needed and that they are supported with the resources needed to deliver services. Funding should be considered for a mental health workforce to support the potential influx of individuals needing mental health support, such as psychological well-being practitioners, which may free up waiting lists for higher intensity mental health services. The Department of Health launched their Mental Health Action Plan in response to COVID-19 on the 19th of May. The strategy outlined key points which are supported by this report, including using innovative approaches to service delivery, the importance of helping and supporting those who have been negatively impacted as a result of COVID-19, and the importance of multidisciplinary and multi-sectorial collaboration. It's important that going forward, this strategy is well coordinated, well-resourced, address those in need in hard-to-reach groups, and ensure that the mental health workforce is well supported. Mr. Deputy Principal Speaker, I now want to go on to discuss the multi-agency triage team called MAT. The multi-agency triage team partnership operates between the health and social care sector, PSNI, and the Northern Ireland Ambulance Service to provide on-the-spot mental health support to people who are in emotional crisis. Mental health practitioners and paramedics work alongside police officers, accessing and assessing and responding to calls made either to the police or ambulance control using 999 or 101. This has had the associated benefit of reducing their reliance on hospital, ambulance and PSNI resources. MAT has been operational in the Belfast and southeastern areas since the start of the July 2018. It has been supported by the Public Health Agency. More than 55 skilled staff across the Northern Ireland Ambulance Service, PSNI and the South Eastern Trust who volunteered to take part in this project initially. After COVID-19 related disruption, it resumed operating on the 12th of June. A team of two police officers, one paramedic and one mental health practitioner are on duty over a 12-hour night period shift on a Friday and Saturday night. It was initially funded until March 2020 under the Department of Health Transformation Fund. The Minister previously stated that he also wanted to urgently examine the potential for significant expansion of the multi-agency triage team partnership between the health and social care sector, PSNI, and Northern Ireland Ambulance. The status remains unclear as to the future of MAT, and we would like to see more regular reporting. As recently as the 10th of September, the Minister referenced the project as part of the Department's initiatives to prevent suicide. We would like to see that continue, Minister. The reality is that MAT provides a vital and essential intervention at a most critical point, and it should be maintained. However, building resilience and taking a preventative approach to the roots of mental illness taking hold is just, if not more important. So that we do not neglect the need for a holistic approach. However, as we continue to exist with this virus and look to the Minister as he leads on the mental health strategy and action, continuity of services will be critical. The crucial role of voluntary and community services must also be recognised. In conclusion, Mr. Speaker, we must recognise the impact of COVID-19 on our population's mental health, recognise the importance of MAT, and calls on the Minister to commit urgently to the expansion and the funding of this project to all health and social care trusts. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Principal Speaker.
Thank you. I call Ms. Orlea Flynn.
And I welcome the opportunity to speak in support of this motion today. And I'd like to thank Alex and Paula for bringing such a crucial issue to the floor of the Assembly. As the motion refers, the topic of poor mental health has been identified, and I think it's fair to say universally accepted as an area of concern given recent events the populations have faced right across the world due to COVID-19. And while I'm glad to see this area of health receive the attention that it deserves, what we need to do next to help those in crisis must be more than just positive mental health slogans. It must be more than interdepartmental working groups, reports and recommendations. It needs to be the delivery of true parity of esteem between physical and mental health. Strategies need funded and communities need services. But importantly, if a person is unfortunate enough to find themselves in that moment of crisis and wanting to end their own life, help needs to be accessible. A great example of how on-the-ground crisis support and intervention can do just that, can help save a person's life, is the example of the Multi Agency Triage Team.
Thank the member for giving way, and we spend a lot of time together on the mental health and suicide prevention APGs and the recently facilitated one through the member from East Londonderry on dual diagnosis. But you mentioned about the need for collaboration and for agencies to work together to tackle this problem, and it is absolutely true. Would the member agree with me that it is to the detriment of some departments within this house that the Desert Creed College did not go ahead, given that a lot of the time spent together between these services is multi-agency, and a training opportunity would have been really useful so that they can actually be better at their job when they're on the street serving the people of Northern Ireland?
Before I call you, Ms. Flynn, the Ulster Unionists have only given me one name. If the member wishes to make a speech, I could add his name to the list. The member has an additional minute.
Okay, and I'd like to thank the member for his comments, and I think the important thing to focus on now is moving forward into the future, and thankfully we now do have that recognition that it is going to take a lot more intervention, cross-departmental working, and that's obviously including the agencies on the ground that's doing that brilliant work, so thank you. As I was about to just come on and reference, I'm sure that all of the agencies involved and the respective ministers can appreciate the value of sustaining such partnerships and interventions, just like the multi-agency triage team, and hopefully this can continue into the future. I'm also pleased to comment that since taking up my role as an MLA and as chair of the Assembly All-Party Group on Suicide Prevention, that the members of that APG, along with many cross-community groups and organisations from statutory, community and voluntary backgrounds, that we all wholeheartedly supported and encouraged this model. We all recognise that emergency departments are not a suitable place or appropriate environment for anyone who is suffering in a state of crisis. We all recognise that when it comes to helping someone in a mental health crisis, that working in silos, whether that be within the justice system or within the health system, that this does little to de-escalate or effectively assess and treat the person who needs the help. In fact, many with lived experience will advise that it can have the opposite impact and it can make that person feel worse. The Department of Health, I know, is conducting a review into crisis services as part of its mental health action plan, as already referenced by the previous speaker. And I'd also like to highlight that other crisis services do currently exist in the models of the crisis centres in Derry and Belfast, in the CAMHS crisis teams and adult crisis services, in the Lifeline 24/7 crisis helpline, and last but not least, in the vast network of groups and individuals who are rooted within their communities and who people instinctively think of when they need help. Therefore, I'd like to make a direct call on the Minister of Health following that review to invest in crisis services and to invest in communities. The expansion and funding of this project for me would signify another small step in the right direction towards genuine parity of esteem for mental health. More progress towards the full implementation and funding of the suicide prevention strategy could signify hope to someone who might be watching this debate at home today, to someone who might have lived through such experiences or indeed are currently living through such an experience. It's important to note that although this multi-agency model, which is made up of the ambulance staff, PSNI officers and CPNs, has successfully operated within the Belfast and South Eastern Trust areas, which indeed lies within my own constituency, so I do know it well, but it has only done so at a limited capacity operating over the weekends. The reality is that a mental health crisis can take hold at any time, and therefore it's right to have access to such services throughout the week. It's also important to note to members that one of the key aims within the suicide prevention strategy is, quote, to ensure suicide prevention services and support are delivered appropriately in deprived areas where suicide and self-harm rates are the highest. And this includes, and rightfully so, both our urban and our rural communities. At present, with the multi-agency team only servicing 2 out of 5 of our trust areas across the north, there is definitely room to expand. So, to bring my remarks to a close, the most striking feedback that I've received about this project has been from both families in receipt of the service and from the ambulance and policing staff who have went out to visit people within their homes. The staff have spoken of a sense of confidence in working together to help someone in what can be extremely difficult, challenging and complex circumstances. And families have described a feeling of understanding and compassion for the person receiving the treatment in what is a much more safe and familiar environment to them.
I think that's probably the very best point at which I'm going to have to bring your comments to an end.
Okay, Gormila Mayoga, thank you.
Mr. Colin McGrath.
Much, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak on this motion today. This is an incredibly important discussion that is being held in homes, in schools and in workplaces the length and breadth of the North. No matter what your age, your job or your background, all of us are affected by and must give due consideration to our mental health. I agree with the spirit and the content of the motion before us today. Never has a collaborative and well-resourced mental health service been more needed. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, we are in the midst of a mental health crisis. The most recent health survey for Northern Ireland presented some distressing statistics. Around a fifth of respondents scored highly on the GHQ-12, suggesting that they may have a possible mental health problem, and the motion makes reference to a more up-to-date figure of one-third meeting the criteria for depression. The report also highlights that the most deprived areas continue to be more likely to have a higher score, almost 25%, than those in the least deprived area, where it is only 12%. We do need a committed and adequately resourced response to this issue. We all accept, for example, the need for a mental health champion and how important the role is, and I welcome Minister Swan's recent appointment of Professor Siobhan O'Neill to the post. I have met with her, and there is no doubt that she is committed and ready for the task at hand. But maybe I would ask generally, just is the executive committed to that as well? I mean, she has no budget, no staff, and no direct authority. And that certainly isn't about playing politics or who's to blame. I think it's just about ensuring that we get the best possible outcome. And maybe if she does, it would be great to hear about that. Mr. Deputy Speaker, it is clear that the voluntary sector are taking the lead on this and achieving some phenomenal results. I looked at my own area in South Down and see the fantastic response being done on the ground by MyMy, Life Changes, Changes Lives, PIPS, Newcastle Community Outreach. These are some of the groups that I work with, and I'm proud to try and help and support them with what they do. And this is nothing to say about the great work being done by the GAA, the IFA, and many other sporting groups. But why should organisations and charities have to struggle year on year to pick up the slack and to struggle to find that funding and to find volunteers? Why are we leaning so heavily on the voluntary sector and not supporting them more? I spent 18 years of my life working with such issues as a youth worker. I have seen firsthand how this problem has evolved, and I can tell you that we are failing our children. We need further support for perinatal mental health care, early intervention for primary and post-primary school anxiety. We have no legislation on cyberbullying, despite the NSPCC highlighting how important this is. Our children are being exploited in the most heinous and horrific way, and we need to find legislation to combat this online scourge and not to minimise the abuse that they suffer. In the last year before the formation of the Education Authority, £1.5 million was spent on post-primary school counselling services and nearly £2 million spent on primary school counselling services. That's £3.5 million. Last financial year, EA only spent $2.3 million to cover all primary and post-primary. Why is this? Has there been a change in budget or a change in priority? Perhaps maybe the Health Minister could liaise with the Education Minister to try and find this out. Being impacted by other issues such as addiction to drugs, alcohol and gambling mean that many of the young people in our society are not equipped with the skills to sustain a job or a housing agreement. And social deprivation in some areas results in third-generation unemployment. And what do we do? Well, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, last year we had nearly 15,000 children and young adults under the age of 24 being prescribed and dispensed with diazepam. Nearly 3,000 prescribed and dispensed with pregabalin. Throw a pill at something and hope the issue go away is not going to cut it. Because the issue is not going away. In fact, too many are being left to be seen by our trusts. And the Health Minister has told me that nobody should be waiting more than 9 weeks for access to either adult or child and adolescent mental health services, or 13 weeks to access psychological therapies. Yet in one trust, I've been told some children are waiting 57 weeks for an appointment. And the average waiting time in one trust to access adult mental health services is 92 weeks. Does this scare you? Because it certainly frightens the life out of me. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I know the picture I'm painting is a bleak one, but the picture does not compare to the darkness that envelops all too many in our society. We must do more, we can do more, and I wholeheartedly support this motion before us.
Thank you. I call Mr. Alan Chambers.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. It is a stark fact that one in four people across Northern Ireland are likely to suffer from poor mental health. It can strike at anyone, young or old, strong or weak, rich or poor. It can have a trigger point or none. For far too many people, it is an unspoken illness. The message that it is good to talk is one that can't be repeated often enough, yet for too long, it wasn't given the focus or the resources that is needed or deserved. There is an unlimited body of evidence to show that mental illness is associated with greater risk of physical illness. Physical illness, in turn, increases the risk of mental illness. One should no longer be viewed in isolation from the other. That is why when the Ulster Unionist Party took up the health portfolio, after it was passed over in this House, sometimes repeatedly by other parties in January, we said we would make mental health a key priority. The COVID-19 pandemic has underlined the need for this area of health care to our community and its absolute importance of supporting the mental resilience of all our citizens. And despite the immense challenges of recent months, the Ulster Unionist Party have been able to deliver on a number of our key manifesto priorities. Minister Robin Swan established the position of an interim mental health champion for Northern Ireland, and his choice of Professor Siobhan O'Neill has been widely supported. He also moved quickly to publish the Mental Health Action Plan, along with 38 actions within it. And given the immediacy of the challenges associated with the pandemic, it was only right and proper that it was accompanied by a COVID response plan detailing the psychological well-being and mental health response to it. In addition, there has been more progress made in relation to specialist perinatal mental health services, the development of managed care networks for child and adolescent mental health services, and improving the role and profile of mental health and primary care in the last few months than in the years before it. But despite the progress, nothing could have prepared us for COVID-19. I fear, therefore, that some within our society will be living with the consequences of anxiety and depression well beyond the immediate physical risk. Longer term, we need a service fit for purpose and one that is funded to meet the often complex needs of our population. But short term, we also need a service in place that can provide immediate and urgent mental health support. The work of the Multi Agency Triage Team is one such form of support, and having been piloted successfully, it was little wonder that it was quickly extended to cover the Belfast area as well. At a time of COVID, with all the additional pressures it puts on our hospitals and our staff, there has never been a more important time to avoid unnecessary attendances at our emergency departments. By putting in place preventative and early intervention practices, that is exactly what the Multi-Agency Triage Team does. And of course, it's not just the service users or the health service that benefits, but it also provides clear benefits for the PSNI. Before I sit down, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I will once again repeat the phrase that it is good to talk. No problem exists in anyone's life that can't be resolved. No weight on your shoulders that can't be lifted. No bad thoughts that can't be eradicated. Just sitting down with someone, a professional or a trusted friend, to talk about your issues can be the start of the journey to recovery and taking back control of your life. There is no shame or sign of weakness in doing so. Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker.
Thank you. I call Ms. Kelly Armstrong.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I would like to thank the proposers for bringing this motion to the House and also, regardless of our political differences, to take this opportunity to thank Mr. Easton for being so open about his own mental health challenges during the summer. That took immense courage. But I have no doubt that by doing so, you helped a lot of people. Naturally, I rise on behalf of the Alliance Party to support this motion. Its wording is very clear, and I hope the response to it from the Minister is as positive as last week's. The report of the Stress, Trauma and Related Conditions Lab was indeed stark, but it was also in many ways unsurprising. As long ago as March, Lord Alderdice, speaking from a position of direct professional experience, raised the prospect in Parliament of a mental health pandemic caused by the sheer inhumanity and thus inevitable severe psychological impact of what we were asking people to do. Going without human touch, without social contact, and without anything which delivers the sense of camaraderie and belonging which makes us all human, particularly of those who live alone or in isolated households or communities, will have deep psychological impact. A word such as loneliness seems relatively tame, but it has profound impact on our mental health. Being detached from social contact and social norms leads to a proven disturbance in the ability to assess others' intentions and thus maintain and build human relationships. One consequence of that will inevitably be, in some cases, be symptoms of PTSD and disorders which seem to be associated, such as borderline personality disorder. And the Stress, Trauma and Related Conditions Lab report endorses that view. As we have heard, one-fifth of people studied, and therefore more likely that one-fifth of the entire population, have exhibited symptoms of PTSD associated with the experience of lockdown. Nearly a third show symptoms of depression and anxiety. Indeed, I believe this could be an underestimate. What lockdown asked of us, as fundamentally social animals, was necessary to manage our initial response to the virus, but it was inhuman in the literal sense. Therefore, I'd like to take this opportunity to re-emphasise that in every response to the coronavirus restrictions legislation, my colleague Paula Bradshaw cautioned that it must remain in place for not a second longer than necessary. There are many reasons for this, but the main one is the profound and appalling impact on mental well-being. I would also caution against anyone making public statements about reinstituting lockdown. We need to be sensitive to people's experiences of it, and recognise that if we are tightening restrictions in a targeted way, that is not remotely the same as reinforcing lockdown. It is important for our collective mental well-being that we get this phraseology correct and do not create wholly unnecessary fear of a return to where we once were. I'd like to put on record my frustration that the mental health strategy has been set back from its original timescale. In fact, it is now more urgent than ever. We can be clear here and now that one of the defining aspects of the pandemic, when we look back on it in a few years' time, with hopefully it firmly in the rearview mirror, that it will be the mental health issues arising from it. We will need to proof almost everything we do for its impact on mental well-being. I have to say, this is the time for speeding up that work, not delaying it. The MAT partnership that others have spoken about, which began in the South Eastern Trust 2 years ago, seems to me to have been a clear success. What it does, as much as anything, is reinforce the need to consider mental health and well-being in everything we do, and to have people trained to deal with it in their everyday lives, particularly in professions such as the health sector and the police, I have no hesitation in recommending its rollout across the whole of Northern Ireland, and indeed the experience of the last few months only reinforces the urgency of this. Although not mentioned in the motion, I expect the Minister will be working with education to ensure the mental health and well-being of our young people will also be supported, given their young lives have been so impacted. We don't want their legacy to fall onto health. I hope we can get some clarity on this from the Minister, and my colleagues in the Alliance Party, of course, support this motion.
Thank you. I call Ms. Joanne Bunting.
Thank you, Mr. Principal, Deputy Speaker. Before I move to my remarks, I declare that I'm a member of the Northern Ireland Policing Board and on the Advisory Committee of East Belfast Survivors of Suicide. I'm immensely grateful to my DUP colleagues for bringing forward this timely motion. For all manner of reasons, a significant section of people in Northern Ireland have poor mental health. And without doubt, the restrictions arising from COVID-19 have served to exacerbate what was already a bad situation. From a policing board perspective, those who serve on that body are all too aware of the time officers spend dealing with those in mental health crisis. Many shifts for numerous officers are spent in NE, either guarding a vulnerable person who presents a danger to themselves or others, or searching for a vulnerable person who has left hospital grounds. Often several hours can be spent on such a search. The police return the person to hospital, and at the first opportunity, due to desperation and despair, they run away again. And so the circle, which ultimately helps no one, continues, as does crime. To be clear, it is absolutely not that the police or the board begrudge such time or resources, but rather that the police often find themselves in circumstances of last resort, filling a gap in provision that's not really theirs to fill, but no one else wants to take responsibility. And that's not good enough. There's an infamous photograph showing a room that looks like a break room in a police station after a significant event. Many officers are standing, some are seated, some are sipping on hot drinks. All are waiting, apparently to resume their task at the finish of their break. But this is no break room in a station. Rather, it's a hospital corridor. That is no place for police officers to spend their shifts when there's so much more going on outside, which they must also address. There has to be a better way, and Matt may well be that better way. I've been delighted to see its implementation. From personal experience, I know it is a terrible and frightening thing to come upon someone deep in crisis. One wrong word could have immense consequences. Hence, this partnership approach not only addresses numerous problems, but most importantly, is a preferable way for a vulnerable person to be given the immediate treatment and support they need from professionals equipped to deal with such a scenario. Members will be aware that last Thursday was World Suicide Prevention Day. Those who represent Belfast will also know that City Hall was lit up on two consecutive evenings to raise awareness of the issue. And thanks should go to the Lord Mayor, Frank McCoubrey, for obliging that request. I also commend and thank those who give so selflessly to voluntarily come to the aid of those who find themselves in crisis. This is far from easy work, but they can only do so much. For the long-term approach to this matter, it was a welcome development to have seen the much-awaited Protect Life 2 strategy published, and superb news to hear of Professor Siobhan O'Neill, with whom I've worked at East Belfast Survivors of Suicide, being appointed as our mental health champion. Additionally, I was grateful to hear the First Minister speak yesterday during question time of the scoping exercise to understand the full extent of the mental ill health problem in Northern Ireland. I do not envy that task, and quite honestly, I'm nervous of the result. But fear is no reason for inaction, and movement on this issue is desperately needed and long overdue. But that's the long term. Belfast, and East Belfast in particular, in recent weeks, have seen a number of people reach the end of their tether. Their crisis has become absolute, their coping mechanisms exhausted, and with the most tragic of consequences. So today, I also implore our Health Minister to give consideration to a short-term urgent intervention in Belfast to prevent more lives being needlessly lost to suicide and before ideation takes hold. We're all somewhere on the line between good and bad mental health. Some of us in this chamber will have had personal experience of struggling and just not doing so well. For those who have not, then the mantra must be, there but for the grace of God go I. Because how dreadful it must be to reach crisis point, to feel like you just have no options. MAT has proven to work well, and I suspect the Minister has little to lose and much to gain by the expansion of this project across Northern Ireland.
I urge him to take this action
as a matter of urgency.
It's one of the parts of the job you hate when someone's doing well. I'm really sorry, but rules are the rules, Joanne. I call Mr. Colm Gilder on you.
Gorma agat, prayer last can corlia. I thank the members for tabling this to Fáilte Rod or Shaw, this very important motion, and for bringing a focus to this particularly challenging area of mental health. And I have to say, I've already in the short time been deeply impressed with the genuine empathy with which people here are taken on this issue, and I think that's to be welcomed. I do want to declare my own interest in the sense of, in terms of my own social work career and work in this area, and in particular, invaluable training which I received on placement working with one of our home treatment crisis response teams. The North's long-term record in terms of levels of mental ill health, high numbers of suicide and low spending on mental health are well documented and have been considered by the Health Committee. The pandemic has no doubt exacerbated mental ill health for many, whether through isolation, through loss, through bereavement, and loss of income and the virus itself and the fear and anxiety that the virus has created. While since January, most of the committee's time has been focused on issues arising from the pandemic, rebuilding services, as well as the broader transformation agenda, the committee has raised mental health aspects of the crisis during this period and has indicated that mental health is an issue to which it intends to return in some detail as soon as we possibly can. Having been re-established in late January, one of the committee's first sessions was with the Children's Commissioner, Kula Yusuma, in relation to children's mental health. And one of the commitments cancelled due to the pandemic was an informal meeting with the Mental Health Policy Group, which we hope to rearrange as soon as we can. Mental health issues have continued to be threaded throughout all of the committee's work, with members raising issues around the percentage share of the budget allocated to this area and acknowledging the inclusion of perinatal mental health within the action plan. In May, to mark Mental Health Week, the committee discussed the increased hardship suffered by those with addictions due to COVID-19. The North of Ireland Drug and Alcohol Alliance, NIADA, advised the committee of an increase in desperation among service users, among substance users, long waiting times for access to opioid substitution treatment, and regional variations in access. They also highlighted the lack of local content testing services for new street drugs and the difficulties that that brings with it. The difficulties for that group of engaging virtually, as well as the challenge of accessing PPE, and warned that their experience and their experience is substantial, suggests a rise in substance abuse often accompanies recession. On a more positive note, we did hear of some effective support from the PHA to the organisations within NIADA and good partnership working across organisations and imaginative solutions during the difficult period at the start of COVID, which we welcomed. The committee made follow-up inquiries to the department on the matters raised, including issues outside the department's immediate remit, such as availability of broadband, which can have a significant impact on access to services and healthcare, particularly given the current reliance on virtual engagements. Remaining to be scheduled are the committee's consideration of the Mental Health Action Plan and a future mental health strategy, and we intend to engage with the Mental Health Champion to that end. Consideration of the mental health care also links to the review of urgent and emergency care. The committee wrote to the Minister recently to seek an update on this work, as we know the pandemic has increased the pressures on our emergency services and departments, impacting crisis response times and capacity. In closing, in relation to the Health Committee, I assure members that the Committee is very much aware of the range of mental health challenges we face and the collaborative, interdepartmental and cross-agency working that is required to address them. The Committee hopes to play its part in delivering the change we need in that respect. I want to briefly touch on the issue of media guidelines, and I think it has been mentioned as well, but I know the Samaritans have produced very extensive media guidelines in the reporting of suicide. And an alarming issue has raised its head again this week in terms of reporting figures, sometimes inaccurate figures, and sometimes on social media not engaging in a way that's helpful. And indeed, it can sometimes be deeply hurtful to those families who are impacted and also to those who are working within that sector day and night to try to work with these. And I think we should acknowledge their input. The other aspect I want to touch on is the need to recognise that this project is one of many health transformation projects which will only work properly if properly funded and if co-production is applied. I'd like to acknowledge the debate taking place later today in terms of the crisis response service in Derry. It's important that we provide services in a way that meets the needs of people and communities that are accessible and meaningful to them. And actually, in relation to Colin McGrath's comments in relation to the 9 weeks, which is obviously not even being reached, but 9 weeks can seem like a year, 9 weeks can be too long, and I think we need to try to deliver services in an accessible way. So I welcome the developments with the Minister that the Minister for Health has put into this area and the appointment of the Mental Health Champion and that the Executive have committed to a significant. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Ms. Cara Hunter.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity today to speak on this topic. And I would like to thank the members here for bringing this important motion forward. As our party's mental health spokesperson, I can say it's definitely most needed, and I too wholeheartedly support it. I am sure that members right across the House can agree it is extremely distressing when a constituent approaches our offices about waiting lists, lack of counselling support, and there is so little that we can do. I would like to recognise the value of the multi-agency triage team. Their work reinforces the need for the on-the-spot mental health support and shows the importance of collaborative work and policies in the delivery of mental health care. In my time serving as a councillor for Derry and Strabane District Council and now as an MLA for East Derry, I have been greatly impressed by the work and the commitment to mental health care from local and voluntary groups that I have met. They are providing vital services to their local communities in the midst of our ongoing mental health crisis and during COVID-19. One such service is the Community Crisis Intervention Service provided by Extern in the Northwest, which provides a safe space for those in that area who suffer from mental ill health and often suicidal ideation. It operates an out-of-hours service on Thursday evenings right through to Sunday mornings, and I welcome the debate later on today about CCIS. While last week's news that they have now secured funding until next March is most welcome, longer-term funding must be ring-fenced for organisations as crucial as this. Since CCIS opened up in January of 2019, it has carried out 467 time-critical and immediate interventions, saving lives. The Mental Health Action Plan, published earlier this year, noted that crisis services requires close work between officials and services going forward. This includes de-escalation services. It is therefore disappointing that CCIS continues to fight for long-term funding. We cannot put a price on work such as this. Last week, I chaired the first meeting of the all-party group on addiction and dual diagnosis, and I thank all the members here today who helped me to establish the group. It just shows the support in this House for an important topic such as this. My hope is that the APG will bring together a wide range of stakeholders and continue to better inform all of our work on the sensitive and complex topic of mental illness and addiction. After speaking with the Northern Ireland Alcohol and Drug Alliance, I am mindful of the members of society who come in contact with the criminal justice system. They have unmet health needs, with mental ill health and addiction often being a primary issue. As we work towards removing the stigma from mental illness, I ask the Minister to please continue to keep mental health at the top of his agenda. We want our young people to grow up in a better, improved and inclusive Northern Ireland. They look to us as politicians to lead on the topic of mental health, so that is what we must do.
Thank you. Given that it's 12:53 and 30 seconds, if I was to call another speaker, they wouldn't have time to take an intervention and reach 1 o'clock, which the business committee is meeting at. So, and Mr. McGrath wants to run down to the basement to get some lunch, I understand. So the business committee has arranged to meet at 1 p.m. today, and I propose therefore, by leave of the assembly, to suspend the sitting until 2 p.m. The first item of business when the sitting resumes will be question time for the Minister for Education. This debate will resume after question time and the urgent oral questions that have been tabled. And the next member to be called will be Karen Mullen. The sitting is suspended. Thank you. Order, members. We now return to the debate on mental health crisis support. And I call... The next person on my list was Karen Mullen, but she doesn't appear to be here. I'll call her once she arrives. I call Mr. Mike Nesbitt.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I declare an interest as a member of the Policing Board and also of the ARD Suicide Awareness Group. Some time ago, I was alerted to the fact that Mondays represent particular challenges for staff in the emergency departments of our acute hospitals, and apparently there are well-rehearsed reasons for that. It gave me cause to ask if I could spend a Monday night as an observer in the emergency department of the Ulster Hospital at Dundonald. And what I saw was endless demand, whether it was 10 p.m., midnight, 2 a.m., 4 a.m., endless demand met by unceasing professionalism, care, and courtesy. And while we were discussing trends, I made the mistake of saying that the big issue was people who presented with alcohol on board. And the staff, the professionals, almost scoffed at me because they said, we have been dealing with drunks since the day and hour the health service opened its doors. The real issue today is patients with mental health issues. Even the physical structure of the emergency department, the Ulster, only has one side room set aside for mental health patients. So when the second mental health patient arrives, as they inevitably do, it's a huge, huge challenge. And that's not a matter for the health minister here in the chamber. It's a matter, of course, for the senior management team of the South Eastern Health and Social Care Trust. And I want to speak in praise of that management team because, of course, when the multi-agency triage team was being formulated in experimental mode, the Trust were first in to say they wanted to take part in what we now know is an incredibly successful initiative which deserves to be rolled out. I also had the pleasure of engaging with the senior officer of the PSNI who was tasked with their input into creating the MAT team. I was halfway up a ladder putting one of my election posters up on a lamppost in the centre of Ards when he pulled over to chat to me. And I thought, I'm going to get arrested for some sort of breach of public decency and taste here. But he was just full of enthusiasm for his role in tackling mental health. And what he said was, of course, the typical police reaction, the traditional one, is not suitable. You know, take Shaftesbury Square on a Friday night, late at night, people pouring out of the pubs, somebody's misbehaving. The typical or standard police reaction would have been to put them in the back of a squad car, take them round to Musgrave Street, and maybe make them spend a night in a holding cell. But if the underlying reason for their behaviour was mental health and well-being issues, a police cell was probably the last place that you would want them to spend the night. In fact, he said, you know, if the person had a broken leg, we wouldn't be taking them to a police cell, so why make this distinction between physical health and mental health? And so this multi-agency triage team gets it right because within that team you have individuals who, in combination, have all the experience, knowledge and skills to deal with people with mental health issues. And I think that multi-agency approach must include the voluntary and the community sector, and that ARDS suicide awareness group has done great work. Civic-minded people coming together, going into our schools, going into our retail outlets, talking to taxi drivers. Just before lockdown, we were engaged with Hospitality Ulster to try and get training to bar staff, because if you have regulars, you're in a good position to know when they're not themselves. And with a bit of training, you don't become a counsellor, but you do know the right questions to ask and how perhaps to signpost them to professionals for help. So what I would like to see is not just multi-agency approaches, multidisciplinary approaches, but we need a multi-departmental approach from the executive. And I'm delighted to see that the minister has encouraged very much green shoots of multi-departmental work in this regard. Because it's not all about the health minister and his department. This is an issue to be faced by every department of the executive. And so I welcome the health minister here today, and I look forward to what he has to say. I look forward to his response, and I congratulate him for his fine work to date on the issue of mental health and wellbeing.
Thank you. I call Ms. Karen Mullen.
Caller, and apologies for arriving a wee bit late. I also want to thank the members for bringing forward this very important motion today and support the call for collaboration and properly resourced mental health services that includes crisis intervention across all the trust areas. To effectively support mental health and wider emotional wellbeing and to address the rising levels of mental health issues, we must get serious about cross-departmental working and collaboration, as has been highlighted here by all our members today. Someone experiencing mental ill health is not doing so in a silo. So in our approach to supporting them, we shouldn't be siloed either. As my party's education spokesperson, I'm thinking particularly of the children and young people and the role that our education system and the Department of Education has the potential to play. The partnership process of developing an emotional health and wellbeing framework for children and young people and by the Departments of Education and Health, Public Health Agency and Social Care Board and the Education Authority is an example of the joined up working we need to see from now on when dealing with these issues. Minister, I ask that when you're reviewing the existing crisis intervention services such as MAT, that the Dairy Crisis Service pilot be part of that review and form part of the recommendations going forward. I want to highlight and recognise the contribution and work of the agencies involved in this project. Partnership working is not always easy, but it can have great results. One key partner that maybe doesn't get the full recognition is the community and their needs. Behind every person who is in a state of despair or crisis, there is a reason or reasons, and there is also a community that needs support. In concluding, I fully support the motion and welcome this afternoon's adjournment debate on Derry's Crisis Intervention Service. The next step must be a joined-up approach providing an equity of mental health and emotional support services across all trusts with the inclusion of a fully funded crisis intervention service.
Thank you. I have the name of Mr. Chris Little on my list, but obviously he's not in his place. Ms. Bradshaw, were you intending? Okay, that's okay. Mr. Jerry Carroll.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Thank the members as well for bringing this motion and the important issue to the floor of the House. Quite rightly, we have been focusing on tackling one pandemic, COVID-19, but there has to be time, energy, resources devoted to discussing another pandemic that has been with us for many years, suicide and mental ill health. People have expressed to me recently, Mr. Deputy Speaker, why there hasn't been the same focus and resource invested in tackling mental health compared with COVID-19. Well, I don't think that it's an either or. I think there's a fair point people have raised when raising that with myself. And my colleague Colin McGrath, I want to welcome the mental health champion being established and wish her well in her new role. And whilst the Minister has obviously put focus on mental health, it's a priority for him as he started the role. I think that there's a question to be asked, is enough being done at this time? Do we have enough resources going into tackling mental health problems? And when the department spends roughly £10 million per year on suicide prevention, I think we have to say that not enough, nowhere near enough, is being spent on certainly suicide prevention. And I think if we're to really have a zero suicide strategy, I think we're spending too little on prevention with that in mind. And we know around 200,000 people here have a mental health problem at some point in their life. That's around a fifth of the adult population. Mind Your Head have stated that there are 57% of people surveyed are worried and stressed about COVID-19. And on top of that, we've seen a 50% increase in significant stress for those people who are working with people who have had COVID-19. The people front and centre tackling this crisis have seen their stress levels increase because of the work they have been doing and the pressure they have been under. Mr Deputy Speaker, it's no accident that my constituency, West Belfast, and the neighbouring North Belfast are consistently the highest areas for suicide rates and self-harm. I say no accident because it's precisely these same areas and others across the North that suffer the highest levels of poverty, deprivation and inequality. And despite general political talk of moving forward and the talk of a new Northern Ireland, these communities and its constituents have been left behind, ignored and fundamentally failed. And that's not to say, Mr Deputy Speaker, that middle class or wealthy individuals cannot be affected by mental health problems. Of course they can, but it is more acute, concentrated and higher in areas with high poverty levels. And in fact, worryingly, the suicide rate is around 70% higher in deprived areas and non-deprived areas. That's a very, very shocking, worrying statistic indeed. And we know, I think it may have been...
Mr Carroll, Ms Flynn.
The member agree and welcome the fact that, as quoted earlier, the Protect Life 2 strategy now quotes one of its key aims is to ensure that the appropriate services are available for the constituencies, exactly like the ones that you quoted, that are most deprived. That's something that wasn't in Protect Life 1-2 and it's now in Protect Life 2. Thanks.
Mr Carroll has an additional minute, but please don't use it because Ms Sugden's looking very anxious over there.
Okay, I'll do my best to answer and to finish my comments. But I agree with the member, and she knows all too well in West Belfast people who have cried out for services that haven't got it, so I agree with her on the need for that. And men under 50, the leading number of leading cause of death, sorry, is for those people. And just following Orlea's point, that too often I have heard, I'm sure she has as well, of people who have been told to reach out to ask for help. They've done that and the help hasn't been there, or they've been told to wait a few months for services or treatment. And I think you have to imagine somebody who doesn't feel valued or has a low self-esteem, they are doing the important and difficult step to reach out to their GP or whomever to be told that they have to be wait and we'll come to you when we can. And I think that's too many people, Mr Deputy Speaker, failed by an underfunded system. Just to conclude, the furlough scheme obviously is due to come to an end in the next few weeks. We have to ascertain how this will impact on people's anxiety, insecurity and mental health problems. And the motion rightly talks about the need for a collaborative approach, but I think the economy minister, the finance minister, has an important role as much as the health minister does as well. And just I'll leave the final words to a writer, US writer, Mike Davis, who said about the coronavirus and mental health, "Indeed, the combined effects of fear, confinement, income loss and the potential destruction of family savings augur a mental health crisis on an even larger scale than the pandemic itself. This isn't simply collateral damage, but rather an integral and extremely dangerous part of the health threat that has so far been neglected. Consider solidarity an essential vaccine." Thank you.
Thank you, and I call the member for East Londonderry, Claire Sugden.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I rise to support the motion. The reality is that many people across Northern Ireland, disproportionately so compared with other regions, are suffering from poor mental health now. What has led to this cannot be undone, and therefore support, as described by others in this debate, is entirely necessary. That said, in parallel to this support, we should have a wider policy vision of how we address our mental health issue. Upstream, long before it becomes a crisis for the individual, their families, societies and public services. Like many issues in Northern Ireland, we tend to treat the symptoms rather than understanding and addressing the issue. We spend a lot of public money at the most expensive part of the process, fixing what is broken. Even if we succeed in fixing, there remains a weakness and usually more cost. So surely it makes sense in strengthening so things are less likely to break. I do not mean to be crude about money regarding this issue. Of course, we spend it where it helps, especially if it saves or improves the life that is all of our jobs. However, how many lives could we save? How many could we improve if mental health did not become an issue? I appreciate the Minister taking lead on this issue, and I do welcome his interventions since his time in office. The Minister of Health, however, cannot tackle this issue alone. He needs support from his executive colleagues, justice, education, communities, even DARA. Mental health in Northern Ireland is its own pandemic. A vaccination will not fix it. Washing hands and socially distancing will not prevent it. If anything, it might even be making it worse, because as humans, we are tactile, social beings who want to feel loved and touched, and preventing that is having an impact. I'm not criticising the public health response of COVID-19. It is, and it was and is necessary to save lives. However, I do worry about the consequences of what the public have had to endure, the sacrifices they have made, and most of all, the lasting mental health effects. I'm not surprised by the findings of the Queen's report. I see and hear the anxiety, depression, and fear that exists because of the pandemic every day in my constituency. I see people angry and frustrated, which it in itself is an outworking of poor mental health. So even more reason that we need to get a grip on this problem by tackling the issue at the source. And Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I believe that source is trauma. As a post-conflict society, I find it extraordinary that we have not addressed the inevitable trauma arising from 30 years of conflict. And it's not just those who directly experienced the conflict. It is the couple who strode through Corian and a day later an explosion in the very spot they walked. It's also nurses, paramedics, and the girl on the bus. The body keeps the score. It absolutely does. And I'm quoting the title of a book by Bessel van der Kolk, please forgive the pronunciation, and it recognises the impact of trauma on both body and mind and how it leads to mental health and addiction issues. From personal experiences and experiences of my previous role, I have no doubt this is the case. Trauma perpetuates a cycle, often manifesting into a mental health, addiction or domestic abuse issue, which then is traumatising others. They then take on their own mental health burden and so on. We must break the cycle, and the most effective way of doing that is tackling the abuse. Trauma is a fact of life, and we in Northern Ireland know that more than most. A generation, and sadly subsequent generations because of intergenerational trauma, are living with painful aftermath of the conflict. Over 30,000 victims of domestic abuse a year, children raised in alcohol and drug addicted homes. Are we really surprised that we have a mental health issue? Poor public services also add to that problem. Women not being supported after a traumatic birth, communities given no aspirations, so drugs and paramilitary gangs seem like a better option. I feel like this executive is keeping a lid on it until the next election. I hear nothing of a programme for government, nothing about outcomes-based accountability, nothing of cross-departmental strategy. And I find that disappointing. I hope I am wrong. I hope that ministers are setting a direction that truly encourages better governance, and not simply going along with how we have always done it, because that's not working. Increasing figures of mental health, statistics of those who have taken their life, how we have always done it is not working. Minister, there is no point emptying the sink if we do not turn off the tap. And I appreciate this motion, and I appreciate your efforts so far, but I really encourage you to lead on a wider vision alongside good work that is only scratching the surface of what we need.
Thank you. And I now call the Minister for Health, Mr. Robin Swan, to respond, and he will have 15 minutes. Mr. Swan.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And I would again like to thank the members for proposing this motion, which provides us with the opportunity to consider the importance of the Mental Health Crisis Service. The stark study illustrates the impact COVID-19 pandemic is having, and I think it's well named, Mr. Deputy Speaker, because from the statistics that was quoted from the report by the mover of this motion, the contributions from many members around this House today are stark and they need to be, because this House needs to be listening to what is being said. I need to be hearing what is being said, and the Executive needs to be reacting to what is being said in the whole. So to pick up on this, Mrs. Sugden's closing point, this is about a whole Executive approach. It's about a whole Assembly approach, and it's about a whole society approach as to how we tackle our mental health situation here in Northern Ireland. Because the pandemic and the pandemic in regards to mental health will continue to have an adverse effect on our population's mental health and emotional well-being. And there's no better time to discuss now how to optimise outcome and the use of resources. Since taking up the post as Minister of Health, I've been very clear that mental health is a priority for me, and to underline that commitment, I recently published the Mental Health Action Plan, which aims to kickstart the transformation of mental health services and includes the commitment to create a new mental health strategy. And I think it was one of my first meetings of the Health Committee when Ms Flynn actually asked in regards to how we tackle the pandemic and mental health. Alongside that, I gave her the commitment then that mental health remained a priority through the pandemic. And Mr Deputy Speaker, I hope that my actions have proven that I have kept that commitment and continue to make those steps, because I did appoint Professor Siobhan O'Neill as the interim mental health champion. And again, just so Mr McGrath isn't accused of misleading the House, that her office has 5 full-time members of staff. She has her own budget with her own ability to spend the monies in it. So she's not there acting on her own. The first member of staff, I think, was appointed last week with a recruitment process now ongoing. She stands alone. She's not controlled. Her spend is not controlled. But one of the things that the Executive did, and I think it was a commitment and a dedication to where we are in regards to mental health, that office, although the Mental Health Champion, is financed and supported by every Executive Minister equally. Because that's one of the things, and I've said this before to this House, Mr Deputy Speaker, that the Executive as a whole has really taken on the challenge of mental health, and even in regards to the establishment of the Subcommittee on Mental Health, Wellbeing, Resilience and Suicide Prevention. And I don't mean to... I'm not talking out of school about the rest of my Executive colleagues. The first meeting of that subgroup was one of the most human engagements I have seen at the Executive, because there was an understanding, there was a compassion, and there was a wanting to do more by every minister who was present at that meeting. So I think the commitment is there. There's many other things on the agenda, but the fact that committee continues to meet and continues to engage with other societal representative groups, I think, is a testimony to the commitment that is there. Because our mental health service exists to provide care and treatment for those who suffer from mental distress. And this covers a large spectrum of services, from early intervention in primary care to compulsory admission to a mental health inpatient facility. Whilst these services are wide, it is right that we now discuss crisis services. They exist to provide some of the most vulnerable patients in a very difficult time of their lives. But before we go any further, before I go any further, Mr Deputy Speaker, I want to take this opportunity to thank all those who are dedicated to support those who suffer from a mental health crisis, staff in the health and social care system, staff in the independent system, community and voluntary sector, and the many people who volunteer to help those who need help, and their family members as well. So many of the members who contributed today referred to that sector. They're vital to our response because of the work they do, the commitment they have, and the knowledge that they have. So I want to thank them, and I thank them on behalf of the entirety of this House, because this motion calls on us to recognise the importance of collaborative and well-resourced services to support those in mental health crisis, and I could not agree more. If we get crisis services right, we can provide timely and good help and support to those who need it, when they need it. Not only will this provide better outcomes, it also allows the already stretched mental health system to work more effectively. It is accepted and has been noted by many that the COVID-19 pandemic will have a negative impact on our population's mental well-being. The Stark survey does indeed provide concerning outcomes, with evidence of high levels of anxiety and depression amongst the respondents. Since the start of the pandemic, I have ensured that there is a strong response to the mental health needs of the population. Included in the Mental Health Action Plan published on the 19th of May is a dedicated COVID-19 mental health response plan. This plan provides the mental health response to the pandemic and provides specific actions, such as the public health messaging, which is including a dedicated website for mental health support and advice, an online apps library to help and support self-help, the rollout of psychological first aid training, free stress control classes online, which have been available since May and will continue to be available until the end of this year, bereavement guidance, and a workforce framework and dedicated psychological helplines for our frontline staff. Because the impact of the pandemic on mental health of the population will undoubtedly create increased demand on mental health services, including our crisis services. Currently, all trusts have arrangements in place to provide an urgent mental health response within a targeted two-hour time frame to adults presenting in crisis in emergency departments and to referrals from patients' GP. But Mr. Nesbitt was right. The emergency department is not the right place in many of these individuals should be presenting. Similar services are also available to children and young people. I think one of the members mentioned or asked what more we could do in regards to working with our schools. In regards to collaborative working with the Minister of Education, we have recently approved an additional 1.5 million Department of Health funding for mental health in schools, and that piece of work is now progressing with the Department of Education. Because where a young person presents in crisis outside normal hours, all the trusts have arrangements in place to respond if necessary, and the young person may be admitted to the regional inpatient unit at Beechcroft. These urgent mental health response services remained available throughout the pandemic. However, Mr. Deputy Speaker, we must acknowledge that our crisis services are not always configured as well as they could be. That is why we are continually looking for improvements. The Multi-Agency Triage Team pilot commenced its service on the 6th of July in 2018. It was a collaborative project which involved two police officers, a community mental health practitioner and a paramedic working together to respond to people experiencing mental health crisis aged 18 and over, who have accessed either the 999 or the 101 system. The pilot was initially established as a two-year initiative in the South Eastern Health and Social Care Trust. However, following positive feedback from service users and MAT staff, the service was extended to cover Belfast Health and Social Care Trust in August 2019. MATS aims to assist in the de-escalation of crisis with signposting to appropriate services and to reduce presentations at accident and emergency departments, because its key objectives are to reduce attendance at emergency departments for those who are presenting with self-harm or suicide intention. To provide prevention and early intervention approaches to reduce numbers of attendances at EDs, resulting in fewer people requiring secondary mental health care services. To reduce the allocation of card before you leave appointments, to free up urgent appointments in mental health assessment centres. To provide the appropriate signposting and support to enable access to services for clients, and to reduce the number of detentions under the Article 130 of the Mental Health Order, and also to improve service users and their families' journey through the emotional crisis. MAD is considered to be a positive alternative to the usual way of responding to individuals experiencing a mental health crisis. It has positive support from mental health staff, and MAD has already been very positively received by service users. They have felt treated well, they found the response to be calmer, and the avoidance of having to attend an ED a much better outcome. I understand that immediate access to mental health professionals has been of great benefit to those service users and that they feel appropriate decisions are being made for their personal onward care. The success of the service has been in part due to collaboration between the trusts, the three service providers and a willingness to learn from all involved. However, it is worth reflecting that the evaluation also identifies areas that would require further examination, such as remote access and the compatibility of IT systems, the fact that staff operating the system have been doing this on an overtime basis, in addition to their substantive roles. So in addition to the location of the MAT team may not be the most appropriate, as it can only be accessed when a police officer is available, these are the kind of issues that are expected to be brought to the fore in a pilot. And that is one reason why it is important to evaluate what is good, what can be done better, and what hasn't worked before we extend MAT further. I am sure that members will acknowledge that improving mental health is a cross-cutting issue, as many have today. That will require collaborative work across all our executive departments, and that the MAT service clearly provides benefits for both the PSNI and the health and social care sector, and indeed wider across society. Whilst I am supportive of the MAT team and value the great work that is being done, it is important that the development of the crisis response service is part of an integrated part of the wider mental health system. The Mental Health Action Plan is intended to kickstart the transformation of our mental health services by building on the good work that has already been done and by preparing the ground for the new mental health strategy that is currently in the making. In my department's Mental Health Action Plan, I have included an action specifically looking at the configuration of crisis services. Specifically, Action 8.2 is included to provide better mental health crisis response and aims to reduce the number of people who are attending emergency departments in a mental health crisis. Because specifically, the action seeks to evaluate alternatives to emergency department for people in mental health crisis, to evaluate the rollout of the multi-agency triage teams, to consider the interactions between different crisis response services such as MAT, the home crisis teams, emergency departments, 999, the police, primary care multidisciplinary teams, and similar. And it also furthers to develop the liaison between mental health services across all our trusts. Through this, I am committed to further rollout of the multi-agency triage teams, but it has to be done in an integrated way as part of the wider development of our mental health crisis response. The MAT team cannot exist in isolation and must be supported by effective integration with emergency departments, strategy mental health services, primary care, the police, and the community and voluntary sector. I would like to say that my officials are currently working to finalise the details for the review into crisis services, and I expect this work to commence in the coming weeks. As in all mental health policy work, I am committed to co-production, and the review team will include at least one person with lived experience, at least one crisis professional, and at least one representative from the community and voluntary sector. A first report is expected in December, with a final report in by the end of March 21. This report will provide a clear map of crisis services across the health and social care system and the community and voluntary sector. It will include an evaluation of best practice and what works, including user experience and professionals' views, and clear options for the future of crisis services. This will provide the way forward for crisis services and ensure that those in crisis will receive the help and support they need in a timely manner. It will also provide a strategic approach to the further rollout of the multi-agency task teams, MAT. Mr. Deputy Speaker, in conclusion, as I have said many times, mental health is one of my top priorities. I am honoured to be in a position where I can drive strategic change and improve mental health services and crisis services in particular. But this will take, as many have said, a collaborative approach across the entirety of the executive, and at this moment in time, I am content that we have that support. I am therefore happy to support this motion, and I am thankful for the members who brought it to the House.
Thank you, Minister. And I call on Pam Cameron to conclude and wind up the debate on the motion. Mrs. Cameron.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. Last week we marked World Suicide Prevention Day, and it was once again a reminder of how mental health remains a major challenge for our society. When we consider the prevalence of suicide in our communities today, it is a battle that I fear we are losing at times. When on almost a daily basis my office is contacted about the latest life lost in my constituency, my heart sinks. What greater priority can we have as legislators than to protect life, from the youngest to the oldest, from the womb to the grave? Better mental health must become a greater priority. We pay much lip service to this, but we need to see actions that back up these words. In Northern Ireland, 1 in 5 adults will suffer from poor mental health at some point in their lives. My fear, and I believe it is well grounded in reality, is that this prevalence will only increase because of the impact of COVID-19. That is why I welcome this motion brought to the House today. It represents a call to action, and it is action that we know works. That helps those who need help and ultimately saves lives. It is not a standalone solution, but a piece in a jigsaw that we need the Department to set out, to piece together, to create an overall picture of how our mental health pandemic is going to be defeated. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I'm sure you're like me, and with regard to all our first responders, we do regard them as heroes, and that is right. It is not an easy job, but in MAT, the Multi Agency Triage Team, we really do have an example of heroes, mental health practitioners and paramedics working alongside police officers, assessing and responding to calls made either to the police or ambulance control room using the 999 or 101 numbers. In many parts of Northern Ireland, the MAT team is leading the crisis intervention response to the human impact on our mental health pandemic in Northern Ireland. And I want to thank every member of staff for their contributions to date in what are increasingly challenging times. But saying thank you doesn't go far enough. Staff deserve to have the confidence that they will have the right funding and resource support to promote better outcomes and ultimately to save lives. So what do we want to see? We want to see the workforce consolidated, the service expanded, and the funding arrangements placed on a sustainable and solid footing. We want to see the fair and equitable rollout of the MAT project in order to benefit all communities and households. It cannot be a postcode lockout to this life-saving service. So, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I do urge the Minister to look favourably on this, and I know his commitment to tackling mental health issues in Northern Ireland is clear. So let us build up a suite of measures to tackle this. MAT, Lifeline Services, de-escalation pilots in Belfast and Londonderry, and resilience and wellbeing programmes across our schools and educational establishments, using our community and voluntary sectors to dovetail with such programmes to continue to help those who engage with MAT to keep that intervention going beyond that first point of crisis. Enough homes have been destroyed by poor mental health, enough lives broken and sadly too many lost. Let us all take the steps necessary to stop this, and I believe this motion highlights just one worthy example. So, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I am very pleased that all speakers from across the chamber today have supported this motion on mental health crisis support tabled by my colleagues Alex Easton and Paula Bradley. It is clear that the subject is very much recognised, and it is good that we do keep speaking up and ensuring that the issue never becomes taboo again. Turning to the members' comments, Alex Easton proposed the motion and spoke in detail about the COVID-19 survey conducted by Stress, Trauma and Research Conditions, or STARC, undertaken by Queen's University, and the statistics uncovered around the impact of mental health in Northern Ireland during this trying time. Most notably, that 1/3 of people locally met the criteria for depression. He mentioned that it was interesting that the media reporting had a role in the impact of mental health and referred to the recommendations, including those around drafting clear media guidelines and a public health campaign. Alex also touched on the negativity and commentary around the discussion of potential vaccines with the amount of misinformation that is out there. He spoke about Matt about the success and value of the pilot, which has not been fully rolled out to date, and about the benefit in terms of reducing impact on resource of all agencies involved, namely the health and social care sector, the PSNI and the Northern Ireland Ambulance Service, who have been providing the on-the-spot mental health support to people in emotional crisis. He also spoke about the status of the future of MAT being unclear and talked about the vital and critical intervention provided by the multi-agency service, and ultimately asked the Minister to commit urgently to the expansion and funding of this particular project to all trust areas. Orlea Flynn spoke next. She said that mental health was universally accepted as an area of concern. She talked about the need for more than positive mental health slogans, the need for parity of esteem with physical health, and the need for collaboration for agencies to work together. Orlea is the chair of the APG on suicide prevention, and the APG is supportive and encouraging of the model of MAT. She spoke about the lived experience of individuals and recognised the many mental health groups which offer help in the community, and stated that more funding and progress was needed on the suicide strategy. Colin McGrath was next. He spoke of the debate being an incredibly important discussion that we're all affected by and should give consideration to our mental health. He referred to the most recent survey that the deprived areas are more at risk. He welcomed the appointment of Siobhan O'Neill to the post of Mental Health Champion and the need for staffing resource to support her work, and we welcome the clarification from the Minister on that subject. He spoke favourably on local mental health groups locally and of his own experience as a youth worker in the past. He also referred to his questioning of the reduction of money spent within the education system on counselling over the last number of years. Alan Chambers said that one in four will suffer from poor mental health and it affects all walks of life, and how true is that? He spoke of the mental health impact on physical health and vice versa, and of course of his own party's commitment to make mental health a key priority, mentioning the appointment of the interim mental health champion and the production of the mental health action plan. He did say that no one could disagree that despite the progress that has been made, nothing could have provided us or prepared us even for COVID-19, and that if there was never a more important time to avoid ED attendances. He said it's good to talk and that no one should feel shame or see it as a sign of weakness for talking about their own mental health. Kelly Armstrong thanked Alex Easton for his personal contribution to the debate by talking about his own mental health. She also mentioned loneliness and being detached from other social contact and how damaging that is. She spoke of how one-fifth of the study showed symptoms of PTSD and reiterated that COVID restrictions should not remain for a day longer than necessary, and I certainly agree with that, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. Matt seems to have been a clear success, and she had no hesitation in recommending the rollout of Matt across the trusts. Joanne Bunting, as a member of the Policing Board, spoke on the impact that mental health has on policing and that many shifts were spent amongst the corridors of hospitals when supporting those in crisis or in search of or in search operations for those who go missing. She said that the partnership approach addressed numerous problems and commended voluntary workers for their efforts in the same area within the community. Joanne highlighted that last Thursday was World Suicide Prevention Day and welcomed the appointment of Siobhan O'Neill and was nervous of seeing the results from the scoping exercise being undertaken. She called for a short-term intervention in Belfast to face the current level of crisis. Now, Colm Gildenew was next, and he thanked the members for tabling the motion and was impressed by the genuine empathy shown by members from across the chamber. He spoke from his knowledge and role on the Health Committee about the long record of underfunding of mental health. He also spoke about the work of the committee and the desire to return to the subject urgently in committee in light of the pandemic's demands on committee time. Colm also raised the issue of broadband availability, especially given the reliance of remote technology at present. Cara Hunter was next, and she spoke of the distress when dealing with constituents who require services, and we can all relate to that. She spoke of her time at council and about the good work of local voluntary groups like Extern, that the longer-term funding is vital for these groups to continue. Cara's also heading up as chair a new APG on addiction and dual diagnosis, another vital area of concern which has the full support of all parties within this building. She asked the Minister to keep mental health at the top of his agenda, and I'm sure he will do that. So, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, there were some more comments. I'm not going to get through them all, so I won't try to. We had Mike Nesbitt, Karen Mullen, Jerry Carroll and Claire Sugden, and some very good commentary from across the chamber today. So we very much welcome the support that's been given to this motion today, and we thank the Minister for his response to the motion and understand the issues that have arisen there, but hopefully we will see in the very near future a full rollout of the MAP project, which has been so successful. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Cameron. The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. As many as are of that opinion say aye. Contrary, if any, no. I think the ayes have it. The ayes have it. If members will take their ease for a few moments, the next item on the agenda is an adjournment debate standing in the name of Mr. Gary Middleton. Thank you.